start. Welcome dear students. So in today's session, let's discuss the microbiology questions of NEET PG 2020. I'm sure you all must have done well. So we'll start with question number 1. The mechanism of bacterial resistance to penicillins via beta lactamases is by. The name itself is implying beta lactamases, means ase means breaking. Okay, so it must be a breaking enzyme or lytic enzyme. So altered penicillin binding proteins, option A, drug efflux, alteration in 50S ribosomes breaks the drug structure. Yes, option D is the answer. That is, it breaks the drug structure, that is, it breaks the beta-lactam ring. Beta-lactam ring of the drug. Okay, alteration in penicillin binding proteins, that is, penicillin binding protein 2A, it is for methicillin resistance. Okay, so this is for MRSA or methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus, whereas drug efflux, efflux pumps, it is the mechanism where the drug is actively pumped out of the cell, and it is seen for certain drugs like chloramphenicol and tetracycline. And alteration by binding to the 50S ribosomes or 30S ribosomes, it is seen in aminoglycosides, tetracyclines or chloramphenicol. Okay, so aminoglycosides and tetracyclines specifically, they bind the 30S, whereas chloramphenicols or macrolides, they bind to the 50S ribosomes. Okay, so question number 1, it is simple question. The in case of penicillins, the bacterial resistance via beta lactamases, it is because of production of beta lactamase, which is an enzyme which breaks the beta lactam ring of the drug, so breaks the drug structure. Moving on to the next question, question number 2, which of the following is common soil transmitted helminthic infection in India characterized by the X shown in the stool? So barrel shaped egg showing bipolar mucus plug and bile stain. Okay, so very very classical, no doubt at all that it is trichuris trichura. So here question number 2, answer is A, that is egg of trichuris trichura, because of the characteristic features, that is, it is classic barrel shaped, brown colored we can see, so bile stained, and typical bipolar mucus plugs. Okay, so in Ascaris also we can see the eggs which are bile stained, but it is usually spherical or oval in shape with the ovum inside. Enterobius, it is typical example of non bile stained eggs. So it will not appear brown colored. And again ankylostoma or hookworm, it is also an example of non bile stained eggs. Okay, so first two only, they are examples of bile stained eggs which appear brown in the examination. Okay, so as I already told you that Ascaris, we will see it is oval or round in color. And for Enterobius and ankylostoma, they are examples of non-bile stained egg. Enterobius, typically it is plano-convex type of egg which is non-bile stained. And ankylostoma, again very very characteristic appearance, because in hookworm, apart from non-bile stained egg, we see that the ovum inside the egg, it is segmented. So we may see a segmented egg with multiple segments depending on the stage of development. So maybe 4-celled or 8-celled or beyond that. So typically we see the segmented ovum in the hookworm egg or ankylostoma or nicator. Okay. Moving on to the next question, question number 3. Which of the following is not true about Japanese bee encephalitis? Okay. So Japanese bee encephalitis, option A, humans are reservoir. They are the accidental host or dead end. So they are not reservoir. Pigs are amplifier host. Yes. Transmitted by Culex vishnoi. Yes. By Tritinorhynchus and vishnoi it is transmitted, and vaccination of pigs can control transmission. Okay. So question number 3, answer is A, because as we all know, Japanese encephalitis, as the name itself is implying, it is a very important cause of encephalitis, especially in the countries of Southeast Asia, including India, where it is endemic in several countries like Pakistan, India, Nepal, Thailand, Malaysia, and in India also it is endemic in more than 15 countries. Sorry, it is in India, it is endemic in more than 15 states. And the maximum burden it is seen in the UP Gorakhpur district. Okay. So, as we all know that it involves the children less than 15 years of age. Okay. So, most of the diseases it is seen in children less than 15 years, but usually it will not involve infants in the first year of life, though some cases may occur, but usually involves the children beyond the age of, after age of 1 year to 15 years, and some cases may be seen older than that. Okay. So as far as lab diagnosis is considered, so usually it is diagnosed by serological methods, using the serological methods like ELISA or molecular diagnosis for the viral genome. So this way we can diagnose it. And for prevention, as we all know that vaccines are available, live attenuated vaccine, that is SA1442, okay, and many inactivated vaccines like Nakayama strain. Or Beijing strain, and also there is a recombinant vaccine developing in the developmental stage also. Okay. So usually they are given to children which are aged 9 months to 1 year, and then after 1 year or 24 months we give a booster dose to prevent them against the Japanese encephalitis. So moving on to the next question, question number 4. A 12 year old boy presents with vomiting within 3 hours of consumption of food at a party. What is the likely causative organism responsible of the symptoms? Okay. So again, it is a very, very important clue provided in the question. Incubation period short, less than 6 hours. Only 2 important options, that is Staphylococcus aureus or Bacillus cereus, that too emetic type. Okay. So here also straightforward we can get to the answer, that is option A is the answer, Staphylococcus aureus. Okay, so any food poisoning? If the incubation period is short, that is less than 6 hours, only few options like Staphylococcus aureus and Bacillus cereus, that is emetic type. Rest all other pathogens like Salmonella, Shigella, Clostridium, all these pathogens, they are associated with more incubation period, that is incubation period beyond 6 hours. Okay, so here straightforward answer, question number 4, answer is A, Staphylococcus aureus. Moving on to the next question, super antigens is produced by which of the following? So super antigens, they are typically produced by Staphylococcus, Streptococcus. So it is again a question with the direct answer, that is option A is the answer for question number 5. Okay, so it's again a simple straight question. Super antigens, as we all know, normally the antigens, they are presented by antigen presenting cells to the T helper cells, and then they further activate the cell mediated immunity or the humoral immunity to tackle that antigens. But what happens with super antigens? They don't need the presentation by antigen presenting cells. They directly activate and also non-specifically a large number of T cells. Usually less T cells are activated when normal antigen presentation occurs. Here they activate a large number of T cells . Okay, so we all know on activation they start producing a lot of the cytokines . Okay, so increased immune response in form of increased cytokine production and other effects. So large number of markers of inflammation are produced, and that is what is known as toxic shock syndrome toxin . Okay, and it is characteristically produced by many bacteria and other pathogens like Staphylococcus aureus. So here for Staphylococcus aureus, we know that it is many type of toxins which are super antigens. They are staphylococcal exfoliative toxin, or epidermolytic toxin, streptococcal, pyrogenic toxins, typically the A and C type of toxin, then mycoplasma arthritidis, then Yersinia enterocolitica and pseudotuberculosis also. And many other viral and fungal pathogens, like in viral we have HIV, then cytomegalovirus, Epstein-Barr virus, and fungal agents, that is Melassezia furfur or pitriasis . Okay, so all these are examples of organisms which are producing super antigens, Staphylococcus aureus, Streptococcus pyogenes, then other bacteria and other pathogens from viral and fungal agents . Okay, so Question number 5, answer is Streptococcus pyogenes. It also typically produces the streptococcal pyrogenic toxin. Okay, A and C are typically examples of super antigens. Moving on to the next question, in renal transplant recipient, which is the likely organism causing reactivation disease within 1 to 4 months after surgery? Okay, so you must have noticed that all these questions we have discussed again and again in our grand test sessions and other test discussions. So all these are repeated many times in the previous sessions also. So again, this is same repeat questions, and answer to this, the most important for reactivation disease, especially after the surgery in bone marrow transplantation or solid organ transplant, it is cytomegalovirus, characteristically causing reactivation disease 1 to 4 months after 1 to 4 months and in the form of either pneumonia or with GI complications. Okay, so question number 6, answer is B. Okay, so cytomegaloviral infection, as we all know, most of the infections are either asymptomatic. If it is symptomatic in immunocompetent persons, it causes infectious mononucleosis like disease which resolves after some weeks, and then it goes into a period of latency to reactivate again further whenever the immune system is suppressed, like the transplantation or development of malignancies. Okay, and then it causes the reactivation disease, which is typically seen within first 4 months after the reactivation or surgery. Okay, and also it causes perinatal infection, so from infection is transmitted from mother to the baby, leading to the perinatal infection. So moving on to the next question, question number 7, 30-year-old man reports 4 hours after acquiring a clean wound without laceration. Wound is clean without laceration, and he had received TT vaccination 10 years back. Okay, so what do you advise regarding tetanus prophylaxis? So single dose of TT, full course of TT, one dose TT and tetanus immunoglobulin, no vaccination is needed. Okay, so usually in adults, TT, once we give the booster dose, if previously vaccinated with proper vaccination, we give booster dose every 10 years. Okay, so if it is given 10 years back, so we can give another one dose of TT, which is enough. So question number 7, answer is A. No need of repeating the full course. Okay, and tetanus immunoglobulin, because already it is a case of previously vaccinated, taken 10 years back. Usually it works 10 to 15 years, but after 10 years it is recommended to have a booster dose in adults, and also the wound is clean and without any laceration, so single dose would suffice. Moving on to the next question, question number 8, drug of choice for invasive aspergillosis. Okay, so aspergillosis, they respond very well to the azoles, and the drug of choice is voriconazole, else we can use itraconazole and other drugs. So here answer is option B, voriconazole, which is drug of choice for invasive aspergillosis. Okay, else we can use itraconazole. Next question is question number 9, maternal antibodies do not provide protective immunity to in diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus and polio. Okay, so it is not at all protective in case of polio, and that is why we give the zero dose at the time of birth. Okay, so here answer is D, that is polio. The next question, question number 10, a 5-year-old boy presents with sore throat for last 2 days. On examination, he has a grayish white pseudomembrane around his tonsils. Okay, So image is shown, but here it is not there. Diphtheria is suspected. And what prophylactic? The age of the boy is 5 years, suspected of diphtheria. Prophylactic steps should be taken for the 3-year-old younger sibling who has received immunization as per immunization schedule. So by this time he would have completed his course. So booster is required only after 5 to 7 years. So if he is fully immunized as per age, so nothing is required in this case. So here answer is option C, nothing is required, that is the answer. Moving on to the next question, question number 11. Recent influenza A pandemic was due to. So recent influenza pandemic starting from the which was going from since 2008 to onwards, and it is mainly because of the swine flu strain H1N1. So answer for question number 11 is, it is A, H1N1. Okay, and now though it has stopped, it is not in a pandemic state, but still some strains, they continuously they can erupt time by time, and they come into the circulation. And now also the most predominant strain is H1N1 followed by H3N1. Okay, so these two are strains, and globally type B is also the outbreaks of type B also occurs. So these are the only circulating strains right now, because as we all know that there are three type of strains, A, B and C. C is not in circulation now. Okay, so whatever diseases or outbreaks occurs, it is mainly because of A and B, and in A the ongoing, the recent pandemic was due to H1N1. Okay, that is swine flu. Okay, the avian or bird flu virus, it is all the non-human isolates, they belong to A type. Okay, please note, all non-human isolates belong to type A, and including the swine flu virus, that is H1N1. Okay, and similarly rest all others in the human isolates, they are exclusive to type B and C, and C is not in circulation. So rest all isolates which includes the humans, they are present in the type, they are associated with type B. They are the human strains. Okay, so it is important to know about the type of strain, because when we devise the vaccines, so we should include all these ongoing strains which can cause infection. So therefore most of the infections, they include these, all these viruses for the vaccines. Okay, so including the H1N1, H3N1 and two types of type B strains are usually there. So either four quadrivalent or trivalent vaccines including all these strains is used for their prevention. Okay, so question number 11 answer is the pandemic, recent pandemic of influenza A, that is swine flu virus. Okay, so it was because of H1N1, and all non-human isolates, they belong to A only. So be it swine flu or avian flu, whatever it is, it will be belong to type A. Moving on to the next question, question number 12. Which of the following is a category A bioterrorism agent? Category A means highest priority and which cause severe disease. Okay, so it is coxiella, brucella, both in category B. Nipah virus, that is an emerging disease, so it is in category C. Bacillus anthracis, yes, it is typically, it is seen in category A. So question number 12, the answer is D. Okay, so bioterrorism agents, we categorize them into three different categories, that is A, B and C, according to their priority and the type of disease they cause. So A is the highest priority or first priority, okay, and they cause severe disease and their dissemination is very easy. Then the B is second priority disease and they are associated with moderate disease. And type C, it includes the newer emerging viruses, okay, associated with high mortality rates. So the category A includes the normal severe pathogens like the bacillus anthracis. Then other common agents included in category A are Clostridium botulinum, then variola major or smallpox virus, and filoviruses causing hemorrhagic fever. And some arenaviruses also. Type B includes all the moderate pathogens like whatever is given here, brucella, then all others like coxiella, chlamydia, salmonella, shigella, rickettsial pathogens, toxins like ricinus communis, okay. So all these are included in the second category, and newer emerging pathogens, they are included in the this is type C or category C, okay. They are associated with severe disease and they are very associated with very high mortality. Example of new emerging viruses like Nipah virus, what is given here. So Nipah virus, Hendra virus, okay, and then tick-borne encephalitis virus, all these are included, which are the new emerging diseases. They are included in the category C, okay. So the next question, question number 13, which of the following is most likely to be acquired by traumatic inoculation, okay. So here all the listed agents are dimorphic fungus, okay, and the most common mode of acquiring infection by dimorphic fungi is inhalation, except sporothrix schenkii, where the main mode of transmission it is by traumatic implantation or traumatic injury, by like a thorn prick injury or injury by a vegetative filaments, those who are involved in the occupational risk like agricultural workers or those associated with farming and all. So question number 13, answer is B, sporothrix schenkii. Okay, so it typically the infection is acquired after a thorn prick injury, and we see the development of ulceronodular type of lesions along the draining lymphatics, which is very very typical for sporothrix schenkii. Rest all, the most common mode of getting infection, it is the inhalation. Moving on to the next question, that is question number 14. Shown in the figure is the HBV CAR test. Which of the following is principle of this test? Okay, so CAR test, they are examples of rapid test, and it is a type of immunochromatographic test. So answer here is, answer is A. Okay, so as I told you that it is a type of rapid test and it is based on capture of antigen antibody complex. Okay, so it captures antigen antibody complex and it is mainly of two types. One, that is a lateral flow test, where we put the sample and the reagents in a small well, and then it flows through a nitrocellulose membrane, and then we see the color bands developing like what is typically provided here in the question. Okay, so that is a lateral flow test or immunochromatographic test. Another is a immunoconcentration method, which is not there. The antigen antibody complexes, they are concentrated in the form of a dot, so that it is a flow through assay. It is a vertical flow assay where the antigen antibody complexes are concentrated, and they give the test will be seen in the form of development of a dot. Okay, so all dot blot assays, they are known as flow through assays. So dot blot assays or flow through assay, like the tri dot test, what we do for HIV and other formats also. Okay, immunochromatographic test. So question number 14, answer is A, chemiluminescent, where a chemical marker is used for detection. ELISA, here again it is a serological test which is based on the detection of either presence of antigen or antibody in the specimen, and here, as we all know, that there is a, we use the microtiter plate with small wells which represent a solid surface, and there it is bound with either antigen or antibody, and then we add the specimen. Suppose we want to detect the presence of antibody, so we will add an antibody. In the next step, we add another antibody which is present in the reagent, and it is bind with the enzyme. That is why the name is enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. And in further step, we add a substrate, and this substrate is chromogenic, so the enzyme breaks this substrate to liberate color. Okay, and if color develops, it can be detected. But after every step, we do washing, and any unbound complex, it will be washed off. Okay, so this reaction will occur only if there is presence of antibody in the serum, or if it is we take the solid surface, if we bind it with the antibody, so the serum sample should have antigen for further reaction to carry on. Okay, so the final color will develop only if the serum specimen or the specimen of the patient contains either antigen or antibody, then only color will develop, what we see in the classical ELISA formats. Okay, immunofluorescence, here what happens to the antibody, like here the enzyme is, we have labeled, attached the antibody with enzyme. Here in immunofluorescence, we attach the antibody to make it more specific, that is why it is immunofluorescence, and we label it with the fluorescence molecule, so after binding it will fluoresce, and then we can detect it. If the direct antibody is linked, specific antibody, if it is linked with the immunofluorescent molecule, like this is the antigen present, and if this direct specific antibody is linked to the fluorescent molecule, this is direct fluorescence. And if we take a particular anti-human antibody and tag it with the fluorescent marker, and if we use this as a secondary antibody, then that is indirect fluorescence. Okay, so there we take the specimen, put the antibody if it is present, and then we use an anti-human antibody, again like ELISA, and here that is tagged with the fluorescent marker, so that is indirect fluorescence. Okay, so they are the various methods for serological methods for detection of the presence of antigen or antibodies. Next is question number 15. Which of the following is the vector for Zika virus? Okay, recent outbreaks occurred few years ago only. So Zika virus, the vector is Aedes. So answer is A. Okay, so as we all know that it is a classical virus belonging to flavivirus. Okay, and a lot of news we have seen that Zika virus, it became so famous because of certain typical clinical features. Like, what are the features? They are associated with the typical Zika fever, that is a hemorrhagic fever. Okay, so Zika fever, fever with rash. Okay, then apart from this, apart from rash, it can also cause conjunctivitis. Okay, so fever with rash or conjunctivitis, and the classical feature that is seen in perinatal infection from mother, when it is transmitted to baby, it typically causes the infection of the developing fetus, and it causes microcephaly, associated with microcephaly. Okay, and it is also reported that it is also associated with Guillain-Barré syndrome. Okay, again, like all the viral infection, for diagnosis we can do the molecular diagnosis, or we can, like PCR can be used, or by serological means using the specific ELISA or other serological methods. Moving on to the next question, antiseptic property of bleaching powder is due to acts by releasing the hypochlorous acid. Okay, so for question number 16, answer is A, it releases the hypochlorous acid and it causes oxidative damage to the cells, and this is the mechanism of action for this. Next question is question number 17. A female from a tribal area of Jharkhand reports with fever for last 3 days. Peripheral blood smear is collected and stained with Jimsa. Diagnosis of malaria is made. Smear is shown in the figure. What is the likely diagnosis? Okay. So here we can see the blood cells, and they are containing, you can see here that we can see this is the terminal or a coliforms, more than one ring, per cell, and more than one nucleus in one ring. And then other atypical forms like a coliforms, what is seen here? And also if you see the size of infected RBCs, it is comparable or smaller than the rest of the RBCs. So this is typical for causation of malaria by Plasmodium falciparum. Okay, in case of vivax, usually one ring per cell, and the number of rings present in number of nucleus present in one ring is also usually one. No atypical forms like a coliforms are seen, and other variants are also seen, like the typically the schizonts. We can see the schizonts in case of vivax. Another important distinguishing feature which differentiates between the falciparum and vivax, because these are the two most common forms, the rest two, malaria and ovil, they are the less common forms. Okay, so usually we get either falciparum or vivax. In case of vivax, the infected RBCs, the size is either usually the size of the infected RBCs, it is bigger than the uninfected RBC. Okay, so here severe fever and from endemic area, and multiple rings and more than one nuclei in one ring with atypical forms like E. coli forms. This is very, very classical for Plasmodium falciparum. So answer for question number 14, answer is A. Two girls in the same class are diagnosed with meningococcal meningitis. Their 12-year-old close friend is in fear of contracting disease. So what advice should be given to her? So for prevention of meningococcal disease, preventive aspect, I think the PSM persons can tell you better. But for prevention, usually the two doses of conjugated vaccines is recommended for the preteens persons. So I think answer is option B. Because it also includes the variants or strains which cause the severe meningitis, like type B also, apart from the A, B, C and W variants. The next question is question number 19. An HIV positive patient with the CD4 count of 300, presence with mucosal lesions in the mouth as shown in the figure. So mucosal lesions are there, HIV patient, CD4 count is less, and microscopy shows budding E cells and pseudo hyphae. So there is no doubt, budding E cells and pseudo hyphae, it has to be candidiasis. Okay, so straightforward answer is option A, that is candida. Budding E cell with pseudo hyphae, typically seen in candidiasis, and very common infection that is seen in the HIV, especially when the CD4 count is less. Okay, so answer of question number 19, answer is A, that is candidiasis. Which of the following, next question is question number 20, which of the following helps in bacterial adhesion? Okay, so it is the structure and morphology question from the morphology of bacteria. So adhesion, it is by fimbriae or pili. Okay, so answer to question number 20, option C is the answer. Cytoplasmic membrane, mesosomes, it is associated with respiration. Lipopolysaccharide, it is the outer covering seen in the gram negative bacteria. Okay, cytoplasmic membrane, semi-permeable membrane, associated with the vital functions of the cells. But as far as adhesion is considered, it is mainly, it is by fimbriae or pili. So it's a simple question, answer is C, fimbriae. Now moving on to the next question, question number 21, which of the following is the cause of donovanosis? So donovanosis, it is caused by Klebsiella granulomatis, or which was previously known as Kallimettobacterium granulomatis. So here the answer is B. Question number 21, answer B, Klebsiella granulomatis is the answer. Previously known as Kallimettobacterium granulomatis. Okay, so it is a sexually transmitted infection caused by Klebsiella granulomatis, and the important clinical features to diagnose this, patient presents with a penile ulcer or genital ulcer, which is painless, slow developing, because this is a chronic infection, so slow developing over weeks, because incubation period, it is also 2 to 6 weeks, so slow developing, and bright red or beefy red in color, and usually there is no associated lymphadenopathy. Which is a very important distinguishing features. Usually there is no lymphadenopathy, but sometimes because of some formation of some abscesses, subcutaneous abscesses, it can be associated with pseudo bubo. Sometimes, otherwise there is no lymphadenopathy. Okay, the other options like Haemophilus Dukri, it is the first, another important agent for causing sexually transmitted infection, and this Haemophilus Dukri, it typically cause the painful ulcer. Ulcer is typically painful. Leishmania donovani, it is agent of the, it causes leishmaniasis. Not at all a sexually transmitted infection. And Treponema pallidum, again, it is an agent of sexually transmitted infection, that is syphilis. Okay, so option A, Haemophilus Dukri, option C, option B, Klebsiella granulomatis, and Treponema pallidum, these three, they cause sexually transmitted infection. Dukri causing the painful infection, and Haemophilus Dukri Klebsiella granulomatis, they both these and Treponema pallidum, they cause sexually transmitted infections. Treponema pallidum, it cause syphilis, whereas Klebsiella granulomatis, it cause the painful painless ulcer, and it is typically known as donovanosis or granuloma inguinale. Whereas Ducree, which caused the painful ulcer, it is painful and it is known as chancroid or soft chancre, which is very painful. And the name donovanosis, it is derived because when it was first it was identified, that time it presented with the small bodies which are looking like which are vesicular bodies, and it is usually enlarged macrophages which are filled with the gram negative capsulated bacilli, okay, and they were termed as Donovan bodies. That is why the name donovanosis came, okay. So it is not by Leishmania donovani, which is a causative agent of leishmaniasis. So please remember the terms, they sound like similar sounding, but there is no relation between donovanosis and Leishmania donovani. Donovanosis name is given because of the presence of Donovan bodies in the microscopic examination. Okay, that is, as I told you, that they are the enlarged macrophages with the capsulated gram negative bacilli and typically showing the bipolar staining. Okay, so that is why the name is donovanosis, else it is also known as granuloma inguinale. So these are the important points regarding Klebsiella granulomatis. Moving on to the next question, question number 22, urethritis in males is not caused by. So urethritis, inflammation of urethra, it is usually urethritis, most common cause is the gonococcus. So gonococcal, that is why for urethritis we divide it into gonococcal and non-gonococcal, okay. So gonococcal, so gonococcus is obviously a cause of urethritis, non-gonococcal. Other bacteria like chlamydia, mycoplasma, ureaplasma, then other agents, fungal and parasitic agents like fungal, parasitic or viral agents like candida, trichomonas, okay. So all can cause urethritis, including trichomonas, chlamydia, gonococcus, except Haemophilus ducreyi. What we have just seen in the previous question, that Haemophilus ducreyi, it is causative agent for chancroid or soft chancre, very very painful sexually transmitted infection, and it is associated with a painful lesion, not with urethritis, okay. So it is not caused by Haemophilus ducreyi, rest all can cause urethritis. So answer for question number 22, it is, answer is A. Moving on to the next question, question number 23, the immunoglobulin structure, which is dimer, okay. So as soon as any antibody, dimer, IgA, should come to our mind, okay, shown in the figure. So simple, it belongs to which class of antibody, that is IgA, typically existing in the dimeric forms, and IgM typically exist in pentavalent form. That is why it is known as millionaire molecule. Okay, so Moving on to the next question. A child develops septic shock following meningitis and examination of the child has a petechial rash as shown in the figure. So we can see the presence of petechial rashes on the legs. Which of the following is a gram-negative diplococci? Okay, gram-negative diplococci classically associated with development of meningitis and characteristic petechial rash none other than Neisseria meningitidis. Okay, so here also straightforward answer, gram-negative meningitis with typical petechial rash, it is Neisseria meningitidis. So answer is B, Neisseria meningitidis. Okay, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, it is typical gram-negative bacilli. Neisseria, it is gram-negative diplococci. With capsule, Streptococcus pneumoniae, again it is a diplococci, but this is gram-positive diplococci. So, typical example of gram-positive diplococci with capsule, okay. Escherichia coli, again an example of gram-negative bacilli, okay. So, answer for question number 24, answer is Neisseria meningitidis, okay. So, with this, I think this is the last question. So, this finishes our discussion of the microbiology questions for NEET PG 20. Thank you.